erosion management, erosion control is a good choice because if you have something that's been impacted by continuous plowing, continuous manipulation of some type, where you have wind and water erosion, you can address that so you can stabilize it and encourage a perennial plant community in the long term. Either by slowing down that wind erosion or slowing down the power of that water to allow those plants to establish the water to go in the ground and those things to grow and hold that soil in place. Unfortunately, a lot of times folks will just get the cheapest guy they can to build a pond for them, and that could result in a pond that doesn't hold water because there's not a good clay base, so it goes dry all the time. Could result in a pond that continuously blows out when we have our flood events. When you do pond construction, you can mitigate some of that risk of the dam failing. You can also renovate old dams that maybe have filled up with sediment and serve their purpose. You can also enhance an old pit tank into something that's more conducive to wildlife management with areas of shallow water for wading birds, shorebirds, waterfowl, those types of things. You can increase the usability of that particular space. For water diversion, you're really going to look at a dedicated need. So this could be things like wing bars and water ditches along established roads where you're coming down a slope and you're so often introducing something where the water that's going down that road is siphoned off, and it can provide some pretty good water, especially in our arid climates, where it's going to gather and provide a whole different suite of plants. You'll see these pretty often where these diversion ditches, you'll have the vegetation will be much taller there just from that little bit of extra water that's running down that road or down that ditch.
We looked at a diversion that was set on the contour, and this was a pretty long diversion. Basically, we were diverting water that would have normally run down a drainage and caused erosion, and we're diverting it off to the sides and into a stock tank. We'd like to see native vegetation, but plants on the diversion are also very good in all situations because they will hold it together and keep it from washing out. These divots that we put in rangeland are just areas that are dug out, small pockets to catch runoff and hold it. All we're trying to do there is save and hold the water to grow grass.
So what you're really doing with gully shaping is you either have really deep erosion or ravines, and you'll try to reshape those to match the natural contours of that environment. You can temper that slope. You can make a much flatter slope to slow down the energy of that water, and then revegetate that slope to, again, get that infiltration, get those roots down to stabilize that soil so that the risk of additional erosion goes away. Because once the gully started, what'll generally happen is it'll continue to erode up the hill. So when you reshape it and you flatten out that slope and revegetate it, it's much less likely to keep eroding. You can get rid of that situation and stabilize it and try to take it back to more of a perennial plant community.
Sometimes it's important to go ahead and revegetate a stream bank or around a pond, especially if it's been grazed heavily, maybe it's eroded. So you would go back in and you would seed those areas. Again, we'd recommend a native mix, strong-rooted plants, possibly some plants that are more on the side of lacking more wet conditions. And all you're trying to do is get ground cover. Fencing can be utilized quite a bit. It's very important in that some instances we need to allow these areas, like a riparian area, to heal for some time. So we may want to fence it and exclude livestock from it for some period of time. Also, something that I promote pretty strongly is to fence it off and make a riparian pasture so that you can exclude it when you need to, but that at other times you can go back in and utilize the grazing in that area.
Anytime you're trying to manage dikes and levees or any other earthen body that's holding back water or trying to control water movement, as you're managing that, most of the time you're not going to want to have trees growing on that. You're not going to have steep slopes. You're going to want gradual slopes, both for maintenance but also to dissipate the energy of that water across a broader area. And so the management of those is critical to their long-term functionality, because if it gets overtopped by a major flood event and you have a really high bank, when it comes over that other side, it could erode it and break it, and then you've got a much larger issue and honestly a very expensive one. So it could help with your installation of water control structures. It also helps with that maintenance for being able to mow it, shred it, just really do anything on it safely on a slope. In addition to that, having a well-maintained dike or levee is really going to assist you in your ability to control the depth of water you're dealing with. So you can control when the water is on and when the water is off, which is really important when you're trying to control what the plant community is that is growing in that area that you're managing.
For each of these practices, a minimum of one project must be implemented and maintained every 10 years to qualify.
So when you're trying to revegetate those critical or erodible areas, what you're really trying to do is the same thing we talked about earlier. You're trying to slow down that water. So in his case, he was using cedar stumps or cedar limbs as that mechanism to slowing it down, allowing soil and seeds to gather up behind it and establish those vegetative corridors that eventually should expand over time. So what you would really like to get if you're doing wildlife tax valuation is something that's reflective of the native plant community, something that's going to support the plants and animals that are meant to be there. So that could be flowering plants, that could be things that are producing seeds, that could be the bunch grass native structure that if you're in East Texas, that could be a forested system. But you need to be able to reduce the erosion that's keeping those things from forming. And so part of this is setting that table for those things to establish and provide what's needed for those species. So when you're replanting this, you know, you're gonna want something initially on that bare ground that is relatively fast establishing. So that's gonna be a lot of annual plants. And this is where, if you're planting a native mixture, a lot of your wildflowers may come into play. A lot of them are annuals. Things that we think of here in this part of the world where I live in College Station would be things like black-eyed Susans, bee balms, partridge pea. Blue bonnets are another good example. And the other thing is things like blue bonnets and prairie clovers and partridge pea, they're legumes. So they're naturally fixing nitrogen to that soil and starting to restore some of that nutrient profile to the soil so it can support the perennial plants that will eventually hold it long-term. Those would be things like little blue stem, Indian grass, and so on.
If your property has a mix of habitats, including cropland, erosion management can also be very effective to protect water quality.
This is a no-till field. The area is only disturbed with tillage during planting, so you've got good ground cover. Ground cover is highly important for erosion control. The more we've got the ground covered, the less we will have erosion problems. Additionally, this field is terraced. A terrace is basically a dirt embankment. They're laid out and built along the contours. On the ends, they are designed to release water so that they don't fill up and break over the top. At the end of this field, there is a grassed waterway, and that's to catch all of the water that's running from the ends of these terraces. And it is designed to move the water, but also slow the water and catch sediment. I'm in a riparian area along the banks of a small creek at the bottom of this field, and there is an area behind me that is left in vegetation as a field border, and that is designed to anything that runs off of this field will be caught and trapped there before it gets into the creek or stream. It's important because we're catching any of the sediments, and also we're catching nutrients, nitrogen, phosphorus that may be running off the field, as well as any herbicides or pesticides that might have run off. And we don't want it in the water because it causes problems for water quality.
Not all erosion management has to be on a large scale. Jim and Christy Wade live on 50 acres and employ simple, targeted methods to improve their property.
Some of the management practices that we have done have included erosion control. We've done some work in maintaining our riparian areas, clearing invasive and unwanted brush, and trying to manage areas where the soil was actually washing away.
Great, so this is an area that we had one of our first trincheras that we put in, which is basically a form of erosion control. So this is one of our main access roads for the property, and this was always washing out. But you can see here we've got three large cedar trunks that we put down here to hold back this area that was being washed out. So that's the cedar logs with rocks that are held in by rebar. And then once they had done that, when we were prepping for the pub project, the Prairie for Appalachian Birds, and we did all the clearing of the thatch, we came in and dumped all this thatch here behind them. So this area right here that's filled in with vegetation was basically as deep as all that, but this has just now become, you know, reinforced soil. So we did erosion control, and then we backfilled where it was eroding. So we're able to kind of not just control further erosion, but recover some of the lost area. This is another both combination invasive species control and erosion control. So this is a hillside. It has literally hundreds, if not a thousand China berries on it that have been here for a long time. So we're coming in, we're cutting them off, and I tend to leave the stumps high enough so that the bigger part of the trunk I can turn parallel to the hillside. So we're sort of doing some erosion control. Some of the bigger ones, like that one, we've cut about an inch in all the way around and treated that with herbicide. So we're leaving that as a snag. But we've cleared 200-300 China berries off the property over the last couple of years and make mulch out of some of it, and then, you know, do erosion control with the rest.
I think it's important to communicate to landowners that you can't just let your land go back to nature. It has to be actively managed, which takes time and takes money and takes research. Some of the pressures now that exist on the land weren't there 300, 400,000 years ago. We've got fire suppression, we've got overgrazing, we've got so many invasive species. These things have to be actively managed. You can't just sit back and assume it'll revert to nature if you leave it alone. I would say my goal is just to restore as much native plant and animal life as possible here.
For more information and links to other resources, refer to the video's description below.